Hey there, I'm Mike, and today I'm going to go over the best practices for writing React code. React has remained one of the most popular libraries for creating user interfaces when building web applications. As with writing any code, it's necessary to understand certain conventions that'll enable you to write clean React code. In this video, we'll help you serve your users better by giving you some best practices to follow when writing your code. But before we get started, I want to let you know that there'll be links to more resources in the video's description below. And remember, subscribe and ring that bell to get notifications for future helpful content. Now, let's look at some React best practices. Grouping files in your folder according to their routes and features helps keep everything about a particular feature in one space. For example, if you have a user dashboard, you can have the JavaScript, CSS, and test files relating to the dashboard in one folder. Here's an example to demonstrate that. As you can see here, each core feature of the app has all its files and assets stored in the same folder. Alternatively, you can group similar files in the same folder. You can also have individual folders for hooks, components, and so on. Check out this example. You don't have to strictly follow these folder structures when coding. If you have a specific way to order your files, go for it. As long as you and other developers have a clear understanding of the file structure, you're good to go. As your React application continues to grow, you're bound to make extra imports. The structure of your imports go a long way in helping you understand what makes up your components. As a convention, grouping similar utilities together seems to work fine. For instance, you can group external or third-party imports separately from local imports. Take a look at the following example. In this code, we first grouped third-party libraries together. These are libraries we had to install beforehand. We then imported files we created locally like style sheets, images, and components. You can go further grouping your local files according to file types if that works for you. That is, grouping components, images, style sheets, hooks, and so on separately under your local imports. Here's an example. Naming conventions help improve code readability. This is not only applicable to component names, but even your variable names, all the way to your hooks. The React documentation does not offer any official pattern for naming your components. The most used naming conventions are camel case and Pascal case. Pascal case is mostly used for component names, as you can see here in this example. On the other hand, the camel case naming convention is mostly used for naming variables, hooks, functions, arrays, and so on, as you can see here. A linter tool helps improve code quality. When using a tool like ESLint, you can set the rules you want every developer working on the project to follow. These rules may include requirements for using double quotes instead of single quotes, braces around arrow functions, a particular naming convention, and so much more. The tool observes your code and then notifies you when a rule has been broken. The keyword or line that breaks the rule would usually be underlined in red. Since every developer has their own style of coding, Linter tools can help with code uniformity. Linter tools can also help us fix bugs easily. We can see spelling errors, variables that have been declared but not used, and other such functionalities. Some of these bugs can be fixed automatically as you code. Tools like ESLint are built into most code editors, so you can get Linter functionalities on the go. You can also configure it to suit your coding requirements. The cool thing about using a framework with an active community is the availability of tools being created to make development easier. Snippet libraries can make development faster by providing pre-built code that developers use often. A good example is the ES7 Plus React Redux React Native Snippets extension, which has a lot of helpful commands for generating pre-built code. We generated some code here in this example using the Snippets extension. Another useful snippet tool is the Tailwind CSS IntelliSense extension, which simplifies the process of styling web pages with Tailwind CSS. The extension can help you with auto-completion by suggesting utility classes, syntax highlighting, and linting functionalities. You can even see what your colors look like while coding. When working on large projects, using different style sheet files for each component can make your file structure bulky and hard to navigate around. A solution to this problem is to combine your CSS and JSX code. You can use frameworks or libraries like Tailwind CSS and Emotion for this. Here's what styling with Tailwind CSS looks like. This code gives the paragraph element a bold font and adds some margin on the right. We are able to do this by using the framework's utility classes. Here's how you'd style an element using Emotion. One of the core features of React is code reusability. You can create a component and reuse its logic as many times as possible without rewriting that logic. With that in mind, you should always limit the number of components you create. Not doing so bloats the file structure with unnecessary files that shouldn't exist in the first place. We'll use a very easy example to demonstrate this. The component used here shows the name of a user. If we were to create a different file for every user, we'd eventually have an unreasonable number of files. Of course, we're using user information to keep things simple. In a real-life situation, you may be dealing with a different type of logic. To make our component reusable, we make use of props. After that, we can then import this component and use it as many times as we want. Now we have three different instances of the user info component coming from the logic created in one file instead of having three separate files for each user. Lazy loading is very useful as your React app grows. When you have a big code base, load time for your web page slows down. This is because the whole app has to be loaded every time for every user. Lazy loading is a term used for various implementations. Here, we associate it with JavaScript and React, but you can also implement lazy loading on images and videos. By default, React bundles and deploys the whole application, but we can change this behavior using lazy loading, otherwise known as code splitting. Basically, you can limit what section of your app gets loaded at a particular point. This is accomplished by splitting your bundles and only loading those relevant to the user's requirements. For instance, you can first load only the logic required for the user to sign in, then load the logic for the user's dashboard only after they have successfully signed in. Hooks in React let you harness some of React's additional functionalities, like interacting with your component state and running After Effects in relation to certain state changes in your component. We can do all of this without writing class components. We can also make hooks reusable so we don't have to retype the logic in every file they're used. We do this by creating custom hooks that can be imported anywhere in the app. In this example, we'll create a hook for fetching data from external APIs. Now, it can be imported into any component. This saves us the stress of typing out all of that logic in every component where we have to fetch external data. The type of custom hooks we can create in React is limitless, so it's up to you to decide how to use them. Just remember that if it's a functionality that has to be repeated across different components, you should definitely make it reusable. There are different ways of handling errors in React, like using error boundaries, try and catch blocks, or using external libraries like React Error Boundary. The built-in error boundaries that was introduced in React 16 was a functionality for class components, so we won't discuss it because it's advisable that you use functional components instead of class components. On the other hand, using a try and catch block only works for imperative code, but not declarative code. This means that it's not a good option when working with JSX. Our best recommendation would be to use a library like React Error Boundary. This library provides functionalities that can be wrapped around your components, which will help you detect errors while your React app is being rendered. Testing your code during development helps you write maintainable code. Unfortunately, this is something a lot of developers neglect. Although many may argue that testing isn't a big deal when building your web app, it comes with advantages like testing helps you detect errors and bugs. Detecting bugs leads to improved code quality. Unit tests can be documented for data collection and future reference. Early bug detection saves you the cost of paying developers to put out the fire the bug could cause if left unchecked. And bug-free apps and sites earn trust and loyalty from their audience, which leads to greater growth. You can use tools like Jest or React Testing Library to test your code. There are plenty of testing tools you can choose from. It all comes down to the one that works best for you. You can also test your React apps as you build them by running the apps in your browser. You'd usually get any detected error displayed on the screen. This is similar to developing WordPress sites using About Kinsta, a tool that allows you to design, develop, and deploy WordPress sites on your local machine. Using functional components in React comes with a lot of advantages. You write less code, it's easier to read, and the beta version of the official React documentation is being rewritten using functional components. So you should definitely get used to using them. With functional components, you don't have to worry about using the this component or using classes. You can also manage your component state easily by writing less code thanks to hooks. Most of the updated resources you'd find on React make use of functional components, making it easy to understand and follow helpful guides and resources created by the community when you run into problems. As time goes, new functionalities will be introduced and some old ones will be modified. You can also join React communities on social media to get information about changes when they happen. Staying up to date with the current version of React will help you determine when to optimize or make changes to your code base for the best performance. Also, make sure your external libraries are up to date as well. To be on the safe side, you should always read the documentation and guides when such changes are made. If you want to make your web app available to everyone after building it, you'd have to host it. It's important that you use a fast and secure hosting provider. There are a variety of platforms that provide free hosting services to developers like Firebase, Vercel, Netlify, GitHub Pages, or paid services like Azure, AWS, GoDaddy, Bluehost, and so on. You can also use Kinsta's application hosting platform. All you need to do is connect a GitHub repository, choose from Kinsta's 25 globally positioned data centers, and go. You'll receive access to fast setup, 24/7 support, top-of-the-line security, custom domains, advanced reporting and monitoring tools, and more. So when building your next web app with React, bear these best practices in mind to make using and managing the product easy for both your users and your developers. What other React best practices do you know that weren't mentioned in this video? Share them in the comments below, and happy coding. At Kinsta, we take hosting and performance to the next level. With our application hosting, you can run almost any app in a matter of minutes with full support for all of your favorite languages and frameworks. And our database hosting allows for easy database creation with full control over every aspect of your project. Explore these features and more at kinsta.com/application hosting. And thank you so much for watching. If you found this video helpful, please don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell for more tutorials, explainers, and helpful content like this.